Healthcare had an unhealthy 2016. The sector was among the worst performers, despite both the FTSE 100 and the US indices hitting all-time highs. And the prognosis for 2017 isn't looking much better, especially considering President-elect Donald Trump is calling on Congress to repeal Obamacare. James Bevan of CCLA joins me now to discuss the financial health of the industry. Hello to you. Welcome in.
Good morning.
Lots going on. It's been a big week in terms of Donald Trump rhetoric. We knew this was coming. We knew that he wasn't a fan of the situation in America, in the healthcare situation. What's going to happen now?
Well, he's been very vocal, and that inevitably will mean that there is an ongoing cloud over the sector, because nobody will want to bet on big profits growth in an environment where he might reasonably wag his finger and say, sorry guys, party over. Mm-hmm. In terms of practical challenges, it does seem that we should expect more competition for the drug companies in terms of cross-state contracting under Obamacare or any successor in title, but also giving individual states more capacity to negotiate their own contracts. Now that, I think, will inevitably put more pressure on companies, particularly where arguably they've been overcharged. I mean, you know, think about the National Health Service in the UK. Mm-hmm. We have an annual drugs bill of around £8.5 billion. Some of the Whitehall mandarins anticipate that we could take £1.5 billion off that bill in order to enhance, therefore, the service of facilities available within the NHS. But the hit of that £1.5 billion reduction inevitably is on the revenue line for the drug companies.
Mm-hmm. Well, this can only ever be a good thing for the patients, though, surely, if there's more competition and lower prices.
You know, it's a really interesting challenge, because as medicine becomes more advanced, as treatments become more available, people's reasonable expectations of what they can have access to inevitably increases. And yet we are in an environment where the capacity for government to spend money to fund healthcare is becoming increasingly squeezed. I mean, after all, if one looks at the level of US federal debt doubling from $10 trillion to $20 trillion under the Obama administration, imagine how much worse that debt will come in the near term as Mr. Trump cuts taxes, therefore reduces revenues, and plans to increase expenditure on infrastructure. Now, there will come a point where markets and politicians agree that unfettered spending is simply not going to happen. And therefore, although the technical capacity for better healthcare is on the up, the capacity to pay for it is clearly going to be under a lot of pressure.
Okay. Now, I mentioned the fact that it was an atrocious year last year. Does that mean that there are bargains to be had?
Well, I think we need to put last year's really very poor performance in a longer term context. If you said to me, what on a 5 to 10 year view has been the trajectory of prices, actually investors have done really well. So 2016, in a sense, has been a bit of a reaction to a very difficult prior period in terms of people trying to find bargains. They certainly weren't there because prices were on the up and it was always going to be the case. In terms of trying to find bargains now, I would say that it is very clear that in biotech there are an awful lot of opportunities if you know what you're doing. The capacity, however, to get visibility on where the biotech profits will come from, I think, is very tricky, and therefore people who are interested in bottom fishing for biotech might sensibly want a diversified exchange-traded fund that gives exposure to the broader sector. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I was just going to say, when it comes to healthcare, it's always been insulated somewhat, because actually people are always going to get sick, and actually as a population, a global population, we're getting worse. We're ageing, there's more diseases around, so actually there's always going to be money to be made somehow.
But the competition is very substantial, and we have very large numbers of companies engaged in research, much of which delivers no practical product. So the cost base for running a pharmaceutical investigation is high, the revenue is uncertain, and of course the intellectual property rights are under constant pressure. In the old days, if you had a patent on a medicine, you had a lengthy period where you had the absolute right to sell that product. Now we find that the period of the market's capacity to value a drug is much reduced, not only because of the patent expiry problems, but also as a result of genomic sequencing and combinatorial chemistry. The capacity for competitors to go, aha, we understand what this is all about, we can produce a near alternative that doesn't breach the copyright but does eat the market share is much faster.
Okay. If you've got your portfolio this year and you do want a piece of healthcare, what companies would you select?
Well, for a 2017 view, I would stick with Glaxo because it has far less exposure to the headwinds of US policy than other companies. And therefore, I would say if I was selecting a single mainstream blue chip company to express a healthcare exposure for 2017, that would be the name I'd go for. If you said to me, well, let's take a much more expansive perspective of what is going on in the sector, what are the trends to focus on, I would say Fresenius, which is a German company heavily involved in the field of renal disease, kidney dialysis. That is a fast-growing market, and they have a very strong position, both technically and in terms of market positioning. And therefore, I would say that as a long-time lock-away, that is smart. Equally, I would say that of the drug companies, Sanofi is very well placed to participate in the emerging trends in fast-growing economies, particularly in Asia. Because if one says, where does all the money come from that will write the checks, that drive the revenue, then allow the profits, you've got to think about where you're going to be, and Sanofi is very well placed. Two other companies I think people should consider. One is Sonova, which is a Swiss hearing aid manufacturer. Because, of course, one of the issues is as we all get older, so our expectations of what we might reasonably expect is not just drugs, but it's a whole range of devices. And Sonova is very well placed to capitalize on the opportunity from new developments in health and hearing. The final pick, which I think is very left field for people thinking about healthcare, is Anta Sports. Now, this is a Chinese sports manufacturer. But one of the challenges one might observe about the rising tide of interest in being healthy is a greater appetite for self-help. In other words, people thinking, look, actually, I didn't even want to go ill in the first place. And rather than popping pills, and there's a terrible statistic that over 50s in the UK now pop an average of 5 pills a day.
Oh, wow.
And I think that's going to recede. I think people are going to say, no, I want to take control of my destiny. I want to do some sport. Anta has a very significant, very profitable exposure to the fastest growing market in the world, being China.
Oh, wow. And health and nutrition, as you say, it's so growing rapidly,
isn't it?
Is there any one of these companies you would stay well clear of?
Do you know, I would be extremely nervous. I've got a little hit list of companies. I would say Actelion is in real trouble. I worry about Shire. Now, Shire, I suspect lots of viewers will have exposure to because it is a company that everybody has loved. But as a result, I would argue that contrarians might say, hang on a minute, if everybody likes it, this is the right moment where maybe we should be prepared to sell into a market that might be relatively prepared to take the stock.
Okay. And James, is there anything else you want to add?
I think that people need to take a long, hard view of the exposure that they have to the sector. I would go for the long-term winners. I would use the downturn of 2016 as an opportunity to reassess where I want to be. And as I say, for me, for 2017, the only core stock that I think people might want to consider owning would be Glaxo.
All right, thank you very much indeed. That's James Bevan of CCLA talking about the healthcare industry in 2017.